Welcome to the video lecture series of Digital Image Processing. Today's topic is First Order Edge Detection Operator. See, you are studying image segmentation, and in the case of the image segmentation, you know that our image needs to be partitioned into a smaller region, and this partitioning can be done depending upon the similarity principle or on the discontinuity. So accordingly, there are three types of discontinuities can be observed in any image. First is point, second is line, and the third is the edge. So these are the discontinuities. So in today's video lecture, I am going to discuss about first order edge detection operators. Let us begin. See, as you know that edges play a very important role in almost all kinds of image applications, and edge actually provide an outline of the object. And as I have discussed in the previous video lecture, that four types of edge detection algorithms are actually available, which is based on the derivative types, template matching, Gaussian derivative, and pattern fit approach. So here I will be discussing about first order edge detection operators. See, in case of the local transitions among different image intensities, they constitute an edge. See, if you are observing any particular image and if there is a variation in between the neighboring pixels, then that variation can be observed as an edge. It means objective is here to measure the intensity gradient, which is change in the intensity, and edge detectors can be viewed as edge calculators. So based on the differential geometry and vector calculus, you know that gradient operator can be represented as what? Gradient operator is represented by del. So if you are talking about two-dimensional image, means f of x, y, there is a variation with respect to x as well as with respect to the y as well. So gradient operator for any image which is represented as f of x, y, means in the two dimensional case, it can be written as what? Gx, gy. Gx is del f upon del x. Gy is del f upon del y. This is how a vector can be represented. And any vector will have a magnitude as well as the direction. So you can calculate the magnitude, which is of what? Gx square plus gy square, it's under root, square root, or it is equal to the mod of gx plus mod of gy. At the same time, direction of gradient can also be calculated. How it is going to be, right? This is nothing but tan inverse gy upon gx. So this is how you can calculate the gradient and magnitude. And you must remember that gradient function are continuous function, and the discrete version of continuous functions can also be used. So here, what is the objective? You must be able to evaluate the magnitude and direction both. So an edge can be extracted by computing the derivative of the image function. It means you need to calculate magnitude, and the magnitude indicates the strength or contrast of the edge, while direction of that derivative vector, it indicates the edge orientation. So this is for what magnitude and direction both are required. Now moving ahead, see, if delta x and delta y are the movements in an x and y direction, means if you are going to evaluate something, how the difference is being calculated whenever we are moving forward, backward, or accordingly. So if delta is that particular difference, first let us discuss about one dimensional where there is a change in x only. So a backward difference can be written as what? This is nothing but fx minus f of x minus delta x upon delta x. See, backward difference is what? If these are the two points, point number 1 and 2, if this is x, this point will be what? X minus delta x. So backward difference is fx minus f of x minus delta x upon delta x. Forward difference, it can be written as what? f of x plus delta x minus fx upon delta x. Forward difference means when you are moving from left to right, means from point number 1 to 2. If this is x, so when you are moving forward, point number 2 will be x plus delta x. So you are going to write it as what? F of x plus delta x minus fx upon delta x. Accordingly, a central difference can also be calculated. See, when you are calculating the central difference, let us take 2 points, 0 in between, 1 on the left and second point, let us say 2 on the right. If 0, this is x, when you are moving towards right, this point is x plus delta x. Point number 2 is what? X minus delta x. So you can see in between point number 1 and 2, what is the difference? This is twice of delta x. So central difference can be written as what? Point number 1 minus point number 2 upon twice of delta x. And these differences actually can be obtained by applying sum of the mass if we assume delta x is equal to 1. So backward difference, as we have written, this is what? Fx minus f of x minus 1, means current point to the previous point. So here the mass is what? 1 minus 1. When you are calculating the forward difference, means the current point and the next point. Current is x, next is x plus 1. So here you are going to write this particular point as minus 1 and 1. And if you are going to calculate for the two dimensional, then you have to take the variation of x as well as y, and accordingly you can calculate all these parameters. Now let us discuss some of the operators which are of the first order. So first type of operator is the Robert operator. Robert kernels are derivatives with respect to the diagonal elements. You must remember this point, with respect to the diagonal elements. These are also known as cross gradient operators or cross diagonal differences. You must remember both of these terms. It means if you are saying xy and x plus 1 and y, means neighboring pixels you are going to consider. So let fxy and f of x plus 1 comma y, these are the neighboring pixels. Then we can write down del f upon del x. This is what? F of x plus 1 comma y minus fxy, means next point minus the current point. This is how you can write it down mathematically. And Robert kernels, as you know that this is a derivative with respect to the diagonal elements, so they can be easily represented by using this kind of mask. Here see, 1 minus 1 diagonal elements. In the second case also, let us say if this is the first one, gx, this is gy. Here also you can see diagonal elements 1 and minus 1. So gx and gy, if you know, then you can calculate the magnitude. Magnitude will be what? Mod of gx plus mod of gy. And edge orientation will be tan inverse gy upon gx. So in this case also you can calculate magnitude, which involves a square root operation, and accordingly it can be implemented. So there is a generic gradient based algorithm. That algorithm is, first point, read the image and apply smoothing. Then convolve the image f with gx. Convolving means here, let us say if you are convolving, you are getting f of x, which is equal to what? F convolution gx. Second point is convolve the image with gy. So here what you are getting? F cap y, this is nothing but f convolution with gy. Gx and gy mask I have shown here also. Then compute the edge magnitude and edge orientation. After computing, compare the edge magnitude with a threshold value. If edge magnitude is higher, it means there is a possible edge point. Edge can be detected. This is a generalized algorithm and it can be applied to other mask as well. I hope now this robot operator is clear to you. Let us discuss some more operators. Private operator. What is this private operator actually? The private method takes the central difference of the neighboring pixels, and this particular difference can be mathematically represented very easily. If you are talking about the central difference of the neighboring pixel, means you have three points, point number 1, 2, and 3. If point number 1 is x minus delta x, point number 2 is x, point number 3 is x plus delta x. So it takes the central difference. See, if you are writing it for the one dimensional, so del f upon del x is what? F of x plus 1 minus f of x minus 1 divided by 2, means you are considering first and third point and divided by 2. But when you are writing for the two dimensional, because most of the images are two dimensional, means you have to take the variation of x and y both. So let us take the variation along one plane. X is varying while y is fixed. So this is what? Nothing but f of x plus 1 comma y minus f of x minus 1 comma y and divided by 2. And this central difference is obtained by a mask. See how the mask is being written. Its coefficients are minus 1, 0 and 1. So this is how this particular operator can be utilized for the edge detection. See, two sample masks have been shown over here. The mask is of 3 cross 3 order, gx and gy both have been shown over here. And as from this particular like value, you have identified the mask is can be written as what? Minus 1, 0, 1. So here you can see in case of gx, minus 1, 0, 1 along the columns. While in case of gy, you can see it varies along the rows. So this is the way you can write down all these masks. And when you are writing the mask, it means you need to calculate the magnitude as well. So for the magnitude, you must be able to represent it mathematically in form. So what is gx will be? You can see if all these coefficients are z1, z2, z3, means starting from z1 to z9, then you can see gx is what? Del f upon del x. This is first you are writing this third row, z7 plus 8 plus 9. Minus of 1, 2, 3. So this is how you have written gx. And for gy, you can see first you are writing third column, which is nothing but z3 plus z6 plus z9. Then you are considering the first column, which is z1, z4 and z7. So this is how you can write down gy. And what is the magnitude? Magnitude is nothing but del of f. This is what? Mod of gx plus mod of gy. So means from here you can first substitute the gx term, then gy, and accordingly you can calculate it. One more additional mask is being shown over here. This particular mask can also be utilized for the edge detection. So I hope now this private operator is also clear to you. Next is the Sobel operator. Sobel operator also relies on central difference. It provides both a differentiating and a smoothing effect. It provides both the effects, and as I've told you, it also relies on the central difference. It can be viewed as the approximation of first Gaussian derivative. This is its characteristic. And in this particular case, convolution is both cumulative and associative. So it can be represented as del of del x. F convolution g, this is equal to what? F convolution of del of g upon del of x. So this is how it can be represented. Let us discuss a 3 cross 3 digital approximation of Sobel operator. It means you need certain mask. Let us have some sample mask which is used for the Sobel operator. Gx and gy are the sample mask. You can see the values are what? Minus 1, minus 2, minus 1. These are the coefficients for first row. Then second row is all 0. Third is 1, 2, 1. And in case of gy, rows and columns have been interchanged like in this way. So for these type of mask also, you can write down, you can evaluate what is Gx, what is Gy. See, Gx is nothing but del f upon del x, variation with respect to the x. And here in this case, first consider this third row, which is Z7 plus twice of Z8 plus Z9, then minus of this first row, Z1 plus 2Z2 plus Z3. Similarly, you can write down Gy and del f you can also calculate, which is the mod of Gx plus Gy. So this is how you can apply Sobel operator. One more sample mask which can be utilized over here, it can be taken into this particular form. This can also be applied for the edge detection operator. And you must remember that the edge mask can be extended to 5x5, 7x7, 9x9, etc. Here for simplicity we have taken a mask of the size 3x3, but it can be extended to a higher level. An extended mask always gives a better performance, right? Next is the template matching mask. So as you know that the gradient masks are isotropic and insensitive to directions. This is the quality of the gradient mask, but sometimes there is a requirement to design such type of filters which are sensitive for the direction as well. So those are known as a template matching filter. And some of the template matching mask, let us discuss over here. First is the Kirsch mask. It is also denoted as K mask. See, this mask is also known as a compass mask. See, you know what is the utility of a compass? You want to identify the direction. So it means these template matching masks are helpful to find out the direction as well, direction of the gradient, direction of the edge. So compass mask, because they are taking one mask in general, in basic, and then rotate it to 8 major directions. You know that the 8 major directions are what? East, west, north, south, and 4 diagonal directions. So accordingly, one mask is being taken and then it is to be rotated along all the 8 directions. And the directions are what? East, northeast, north, northwest, west, southwest, south, and southeast. So these are the 8 particular directions. Let us discuss the mask. Here you can see 8 masks have been shown over here, starting from M0 to M7. And you can see, if you take M0 as a basic one, then by rotating it you can get the remaining mask. You can see over here, what is the first row? The first row is minus 3, minus 3 and 5. Here the coefficient is second row last column, 5. If you rotate it, when you rotate it, it will be coming to this position, this will be coming to this position, this will be coming to this position, and it will move downward. Now the first row coefficients will be minus 3, 5, 5, and this first minus 3 is coming out over here. That you can observe in the case of the M1. Minus 3, minus 3, 5 and 5. Accordingly, again if you are rotating, like if the next coefficient is 5 as well, if you are again rotating, so 1 and 1, 1 coefficients will be shifted over here, and accordingly you will be able to get all the 8 masks. So this is how the K mask is work. And each and every mask is applied to the image, you must remember it. All the 8 masks must be applied to the image and convolution process will be carried out. And the magnitude of the final edge is the maximum value of all the 8 masks. So whatever the maximum value you are getting, that will give you the final result. And edge direction. What is the edge direction over here? It is the direction which is associated with the mask which produces maximum magnitude. So maximum magnitude on the basis of this direction of edge can be evaluated. Second type of template matching mask is Robinson compass mask. See, a special mask for Robinson edge operator, and here it is also going to be used for all the directions. So some of the sample mass can be shown over here. And this is similar to K-mask, and it produces the maximum value which defines the direction of the edge. You can see over here all the 8 masks. This first mask is being shown. Let us say this is M1, M2, and you can see in the first, when it is being rotated, then this particular value is like being obtained. So when it is being rotated, this 1 is being shifted over here, 0 is being shifted at this particular point, 2 is shifted to this point, 1 is shifted to this point, and you are getting M2. If you rotate again, then you will be getting M3, accordingly M4, M5, up to M8. So this particular mask is also performs well for the edge detection, and the results of remaining mask, like here, the computational efforts can be reduced in comparison to the K mask. It involves less computational efforts. Next is the fry chain mask. What is this mask? This is also a template matching mask. So here any image can be considered as the weighted sum of 9 fry chain marks. Weighted sum of this. And how the weights are obtained? The weights are obtained by a process which is known as a projecting process. By overlaying a 3x3 image onto each mask. For every mask, image is like overlying over there. And then summing the multiplication of the coinciding terms. You have studied this in the case of the filters as well. In this case, the 9 masks which are actually being used and available, the first 4 masks represents the edge space. Next 4 masks represents line space, line subspace you must say. And the last one represent average subspace. Let us see the different type of mask over here. See W1, W2, W3 and W4. You can see these are edge space. While W5, 6, 7 and 8, these are line subspace. You can observe line in each and every case. Vertical, horizontal accordingly, or like slanted line. And the W9, which is the last one, it represents average subspace. So this is how this fry chain mask can be understood, and it can also be applied for the first order edge detection operator. Topic for the next video lecture is second order derivative filters. Thank you so much for watching this video.